Morning. Welcome. I'm glad you made it up this morning. Is anybody else tired besides me? But we're here to worship our Lord, and as we move closer and closer to Easter, to Jesus' journey to the cross, and then of course through the cross and the grave, this morning our focus on what is in many parts of the church Passion Sunday is on the cross. So here's a song that we learned last year on Good Friday, and a song that we'll be doing again today. So if you want to stand, the words will be on the screen in front of you.
Sin of man and wrath. no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah.
If you are able to continue standing, please do so and join me in the call to worship. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciple, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." From that time on, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things at the hands of the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and on the third day be raised to life. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Thank you. join me in the opening prayer. God of all time, as we turn our attention towards the cross this Lenten season, help us to call to mind these past events in Jesus' life so that we can sense their significance for our present lives and for the future you are preparing for all creation. In Jesus' name, amen.
Everyone, and welcome again, those of you who have joined us since my first welcome. Nice to have you here this morning. Glad you got up. I'm tired this morning. I bet you are too. Good for us to be together, to be able to worship our Lord, to be able to fellowship with one another. I'm glad you're here this morning. If you're visiting this morning, a very special welcome to you. You are a guest, and it's always nice to have visitors with us. Note the announcements, the things going on in your bulletin, in the purple insert. Linda's been on vacation. I think pretty much our focus is on Easter. So next Sunday will be a wonderful celebratory Sunday as we have our palm procession and celebrate Palm Sunday. But then also as we conclude the service by stripping the chancel and preparing for Holy Week and focus on Jesus' time of suffering. And Monday, Thursday, I encourage people to come out. The last several years, we've had a special kids track for Monday, Thursday, where the kids have a little lesson and they learn about the Last Supper and washing feet and things like that. So families, bring your kids out. It's such an important night. We encourage you to come. I know it's not always easy at that bedtime hour. But come on out on Thursday to celebrate a very special Monday, Thursday service, and then Good Friday with the town, and then, of course, Easter Sunday. So that's all. I can't believe. Here it is, all compact in March this month. Note the other things going on in your bulletin. Anything else that needs to be announced this morning? Okay. We have had a season of welcoming in new members, and last week we sort of had our big group pulled together. We have 16 people that have chosen to join our church this winter, spring. Last week we got 13 of them, and there were three that weren't able to make it last week. I'd like to invite them up front. Rick and Christina Christoph. As many of you know, Rick was in a car accident, and Rick, we're so glad you're here and doing better. Broke his arm. And Joseph Baresi, and come on up with his son, Andrew. How are you? Good to see you, Rick. Joseph, Andrew, Christina, welcome. So last week we had a full insert in the bulletin, and I didn't want to reprint it, but the way people join our church is by reaffirming their faith. So I'm going to ask all of you to recite the memorized statement of faith. right there is welcoming you aboard, okay? I have the questions from, John shut it off here. You don't have to turn around, I'll read them to you. So this is the simplest profession of faith that there is, that one would profess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. So would you say with me, Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior.
Amen. And do you desire to become members of our church family and to join together with us in following Jesus Christ? Do you promise by the grace of God to live in accordance with the teachings of Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Yes, I do. Good. These are all acceptable answers. Do you promise according to the grace given to you to seek to grow in the Christian faith, to be faithful members of the Church of Jesus Christ, and to use your gifts to contribute to the work of the local church as it serves this community and the world? I do. Then we welcome you in as members. With the members of this congregation, please join me in saying this together. We welcome you with joy into the membership of this church and into the common life we share. We promise you our friendship and our prayers as we share the hopes and labors of the Church of Jesus Christ. By the power of the Holy Spirit, may we continue to grow together in the knowledge and love of God and witness of our risen Savior. Amen. By the way, I didn't do this at the beginning, but let me actually introduce these folks to you. So Rick and Christina Kristoff, they are from Princeton. I believe, Rick, you said you're like a fourth generation Princeton guy. And they came down here and said, we like this church. This is a church where, God willing, we would like to raise our kids. And so we're glad to have you here. And Joseph, and Christina is not a Princeton resident, but she's a Sunday school teacher. She will be. That's prophecy. She is a second grade teacher in public schools. Rick works for the government. I could tell you what he does, but we'd have to eliminate you all. And Joseph came over to the church. He's kind of in transition period, looking for work, and decided he wanted to get out. He lives up in Holden Hills and wanted to get out and meet some more people, and has been here for a couple of months. And this is his son, Andrew, who is often here with us. So welcome to all of you. Nice to have you with us. And be sure to greet these new members following coffee hour and welcome them in. Thank you. Children. Actually, it says God's sightings. That was our God's sighting. We found three members. It is so important, and I'll emphasize it more in our sermon today. God is doing stuff in your lives, and I know it's hard to get up front, but we need to hear it. The things he's doing in your lives is not just to encourage and bless you, but to encourage and bless the body of Christ. So I need a few more of you to take the challenge and say, God is doing something, I'm learning something, I'm growing in some way. Maybe you're failing in some way, but learning God's grace. Either way, the people of this church need to hear it. So we don't have anyone to share a God sighting this morning, but I hope we will down the road. Kids, we're glad you're here and all you're learning and the way God's working in your life. You may now be dismissed for Sunday school. That is pretty funny, that Sunday school teacher slip up there. But that could be any one of you here. You know, our children's ministry is such an important part. And as we move to prayer today, let me just acknowledge that. So right now, our children and youth ministry is such an important part of our church. And right now, we're understaffed. We do not have a youth director right now. And I realized, I don't think we've made it public to the whole congregation, though the leaders and the ministry teams know, but Janelle is stepping down from coordinator of children's ministry at the end of this year. So that position is vacant as well. So we found in the past, now today actually the exploratory team for assistant pastor with an emphasis in youth ministry. I said, Terry, we got to come up with an acronym for that, you know. But is meeting today, so we're moving forward at your approval and blessing at the meeting to look for an assistant pastor, but that's going to be a year or so down the road at the earliest. So in the meantime, we have these positions to fill. We need people to step into the gap to help us with youth ministry. We need someone to be a coordinator of children's ministry. Those jobs will be posted shortly, and we'll be forming search teams. And we've often found with these smaller part-time jobs that it's usually people from the congregation who fit the bill best for a number of reasons that I won't explain right now. But please keep that in your prayers. We love our kids and we love our teens, and we really want to have a fruitful ministry as we've been blessed to over the years. So pray for us, and maybe God is calling some of you to be a part of that. Now, joys and concerns this morning. We do rejoice with Rick. Again, he was in a car accident. So honestly, you must be glad too that it wasn't worse than it is. And is your arm going to fully recover, Rick?
Yes.
It was a what?
The tree actually fell on my arm.
Oh my gosh. Were you moving when it fell?
Well, I was trying to clear a tree out of the driveway.
Oh, I gotcha. Wow. Well, I'm glad you're okay. We will keep Rick in our prayers, Joseph in our prayers, our new members. Tracy Sundin had her surgery and is recovering well, and we will probably see her back in church soon. Laura Hamill had asked for prayers, and we didn't share joys and concerns last week, of course, for her sister Amy, who had had such a difficult time with her pregnancy, and rejoiced that she had a baby boy, right?
Yes.
And a healthy baby boy. And how is Amy doing? Better?
Getting there.
Getting there? Good. Other joys and concerns this morning? Lori. Wow, so older people with health issues themselves caring for their children, that's a lot. We'll keep them in our prayers. What was Larry's, was it mother's name?
Mimi has Johnny, and he's already retired.
So Mimi and Donnie and Norma.
He was supposed to live to his 20s, and he's now 67.
Wow, so praise God for that. Yes, Kate. Luke, I tell you, joy and concern, 13, teenager, good luck, we'll pray for you, wonderful. Chuck? Oh, of course, yes, and many of you know, thank you Chuck, Jill Nugent, they had fire in their house this week. It was a fire that started in the basement. Most of the damage was smoke, but tremendous smoke damage, so they're out of their house for, I guess, about a month. 6 months. Wow. So Jill is Laura's cousin, so the Hamels stay in touch. So Jill sent around a prayer request saying thank you for all the support and prayer, and let's continue to keep her in our prayers. Once the smoke clears, pun intended, she'll have a little better idea of what the needs are in terms of, and there's many people who've offered to help, and the Care Network and myself were there, and we know that you are in queue if we need your help. So keep Jill in your prayers. She's not in the choir today, is she?
No.
Seems like it'd be a nice, warm place to be. Catherine?
Prayers for a young family that won't use their name, but they're in crisis. It's a young children involved and couples having severe marital issues.
So for a young family in crisis with young children, I assume?
Yes.
Keep them in your prayers. Sandy? Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Tell me her first name again. For Sandy's sister, Debbie, who is going in for cancer, for surgery. They still don't know if it's cancer, but they're pretty sure it is, right? For kidney surgery this week. Skills?
Bloomberg has it that one of our members turned 91 yesterday.
Betty Kessley. Happy birthday. Betty turned 91 yesterday. Betty drives herself to church. Of course, she brought a guest today, her daughter-in-law. Every Sunday, drives to Bible study. She's here faithfully. What's your excuse? Happy birthday, Betty. Welcome. Anything else this morning? Doug?
Chris has the flu.
Chris King has the flu. Greg?
Cole's college curling team is doing back from Minnesota. So safe travel.
I love that Cole is doing curling. It's just, that's such a Cole thing, you know? Cole's curling, it's almost like a tongue twister. Cole's curling team traveling back home. Skills?
Dr. Jim Beersley, they made it to Connecticut, but his wife Jackie was in the hospital for a period of time. She's back home now. But they're still back home in Southern Maine.
Okay. Pray for Jim and Jackie Beersley as they resettle down near family in Connecticut, and for Jackie, who has been in the hospital. Barb?
I don't know the details of Judy Evangelitis.
Oh, thank you. My brain's foggy this morning. So Judy Evangelitis has been in the hospital. I don't know if she came home yesterday. Does anybody know? I saw her Friday. But she had some falling, just kind of enzyme imbalance, whatever that means, I don't know. But she's well, and thank you for your prayers, and thank you for mentioning her. Anybody else? I see a finger, but I don't see what it's attached to. Bud? Okay. For Bud and Alice's daughter, Mary Lou, who's in the hospital. I believe she has cancer, right? Is it cancer, Alice? They can't hear me. Anything else? Yes, Mary Ann.
There's something my dog actually picked up mine.
No?
She's only 5 and they usually last till 15, and she's already has knee issues, so we have to carry her up the stairs. Plan on bringing her to the vet tomorrow, but she is something.
What's her name? Penny the dog, who's 5 years old. I agree. My dog's 14 and has cancer. I don't know how much longer he's going to be with us, but 5 is too young. Anything else? You know, I like that when we pray for pets and things, sometimes it seems so small, but not for God. God has endless capacity to care about the little tiny things while he's caring about the great big things. And that's the beauty of God. And so thank you for sharing that. Let's bring these things. You can tell my brain's a little foggy this morning, but the Lord is always on duty and alert. Let's bring these before our God in prayer. Dear God, thank you for this day. Thank you for life. Thank you for salvation in your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for inviting us into relationship with you and filling us with your Holy Spirit. Lord, we are unworthy. There's no way around that. But you have made us worthy. You've washed us. You've cleansed us. You've clothed us in the love and righteousness of your Son. And so, Lord, in him we find comfort. In him we find security. In him we find confidence. In him we find peace and rest and strength to do all that you've called us to do. Lord, it is in his name and in all that he has given us by your grace that we come before you this morning. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Lord, we lift before you those who have been mentioned. We pray for Lori. We pray for Tracy. We pray for Norma and Eric. We pray for Mimi and Donnie and the situations that they find themselves in. We rejoice with Luke and his 13th birthday, and we pray for all of our teenagers and pray that you would bless them in this season of transition. Pray that you would show us how we can encourage and help them down this road and help them to bring faith into their lives in the midst of their teen years. Continue to bless our youth program and our confirmation program. Continue to bless our Sunday school as we seek to help parents to raise up their children in the love and fear of the Lord. And provide for us people who are willing to step into those positions, bring to us the right people. We also bring before you our desire to add another pastor to our church and pray that you would bless that venture as we head out on it today with our first committee meeting. Lord, we pray for the Nugent family and ask that you would be with them and thank you that they have a place to stay with Jill's sister and pray that you would help them in the cleanup and restoration of their house and give them peace in the midst of the unsettlement of all of this. Thank you that everyone was okay, minus one cat. Lord, we pray for the family in crisis with young children and the marital issues that they're going through, Lord. And that's just not one family, Lord. That's many families, Lord, and perhaps even some right here. Be with our families. Be with our marriages, Lord. We know that you came to bring peace and harmony and reconciliation. Lord, help us to work out our relationships and our differences and our hurts amongst each other. May peace begin in our homes and our families. We pray for Debbie and the kidney surgery that she's facing this week. Watch over her, Lord. We rejoice with Betty and her 91 years and thank you for the health and the strength that she has. And thank you for her family and her faith. We pray for Chris as he's down with the flu. We pray for Cole as he returns home with his curling team. We pray for Jim and Jackie as they resettle to Connecticut and be with Jackie as she recovers from whatever brought her into the hospital. We pray for Judy as she recovers from what brought her into the hospital as well. We pray for Mary Lou and as she is in the hospital and ask you to be with her. Oh Lord, there are many people who are in the hospital, many who are in need of care and of healing. We ask, Lord, that you would watch over them. We would love to see miracles, Lord. We'd love to see doctors scratching their heads, say, I don't know how that changed, and we give glory to you for those things. We thank you also for the gift of medicine, Lord, and ask that you would continue to open our eyes to new and better treatments for all sorts of diseases, and thank you for the ones we already have. Bless our healthcare system and the whole insurance industry and government healthcare that supports it, Lord. And thank you. It is truly a blessing in the midst of sometimes its frustrations. And Lord, we pray for Penny the dog, and thank you for our pets, and thank you for all that you give us, big and small, that blesses us, and pray that Penny would have a longer life than perhaps is feared. Lord, these are the prayers that we've shared together in this room in our fellowship this morning. We have others that are on our hearts and minds. We pause now to bring them before you in this moment of silent prayer. O Lord, hear our prayers. Be with us, be with our family and our friends. Be with our church as we continue to grow and mature into the people you desire us to be. Help us in the areas where we really would desire to see more fruit, and thank you for the areas where we already do see fruit. Keep us healthy, Lord. Keep us in you. Lord, thank you for the body of Christ worldwide that we are a part of, and may we see increasing unity in the body of Christ. And Lord, be with us in this world as we see often starkly the contrast between dark and light. Help us not to be afraid, but to trust in you. We give you our government and the governments of the world and the peace and prosperity and the conflicts that we find in various places. We long, Lord, for the day when your kingdom will come in all of its fullness. when every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, when peace will reign and when prosperity and true eternal life will be ours forever. Lord, until that day, we persevere. Along with all the saints who persevered in every generation, along with all the saints who persevere in every country and nook and cranny of this globe, persevere in the name of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray and who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, choir. That's one of my favorite songs, maybe some of yours too. As we continue to worship our Lord this morning, I invite you to turn in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Page number is printed in your bulletin if that's helpful to you. We are getting near the end of our journey through the book of 1 Corinthians. I will say, as we begin towards the end of, I'm going to read the first part of the chapter, and then Debbie is going to read the second part. She is going to read a part that says women are not allowed to speak in church. Debbie has our permission and blessing. She's looking at me. Not that I need it anyway. So we're going to talk about that a little bit. But we take God's word seriously. That's why we read it all and seek to understand it through the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 1. Follow the way of love and eagerly desire the gifts of the Spirit, especially prophecy. For anyone who speaks in a tongue does not speak to people but to God. Indeed, no one understands them. They utter mysteries by the Spirit.
But the one who prophesies speaks to people for their strengthening, encouraging, and comfort. Anyone who speaks in a tongue edifies themselves, but the one who prophesies edifies the church. I would like every one of you to speak in tongues, but I would rather have you prophesy. The one who prophesies is greater than the one who speaks in tongues, unless someone interprets so that the church may be edified. Now, brothers and sisters, if I come to you and speak in tongues, what good will I be to you unless I bring some revelation or knowledge or prophecy or word of instruction? Even in the case of lifeless things that make sounds, such as the pipe or harp, how will anyone know what tune is being played unless there is a distinction in the notes? Again, if the trumpet does not sound a clear call, who will get ready for battle? So it is with you. Unless you speak intelligible words with your tongue, how will anyone know what you are saying? You will just be speaking into the air. Undoubtedly, there are all sorts of languages in the world, yet none of them is without meaning. If then I do not grasp the meaning of what someone is saying, I'm a foreigner to the speaker, and the speaker is a foreigner to me. So it is with you. Since you are eager for the gifts of the Spirit, try to excel in those that build up the church. For this reason, the one who speaks in a tongue should pray that he may interpret what they say. For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my mind is unfruitful. So what shall I do? I will pray with my spirit, but I will also pray with my understanding. I will sing with my spirit, but I will also sing with my understanding. Otherwise, when you are praising God in the Spirit, how can someone else who is now put in the position of an inquirer say amen to your thanksgiving, since they do not know what you're saying? You are giving thanks well enough, but no one else is edified. I thank God that I speak in tongues more than all of you, but in the church I would rather speak 5 intelligible words to instruct others than 10,000 words in a tongue. Brothers and sisters, stop thinking like children. In regards to evil, be infants. But in your thinking, be adults. In the law, it is written, with other tongues and through the lips of foreigners, I will speak to this people. But even then, they will not listen to me, says the Lord. Tongues, then, are a sign, not for believers, but for unbelievers. Prophecy, however, is not for unbelievers, but for believers. So if the whole church comes together and everyone speaks in tongues and inquirers or unbelievers come in, Will they not say that you are out of your mind? But if an unbeliever or an inquirer comes in while everyone is prophesying and are convicted of their sins and are brought under judgment by all, as the secrets of their hearts are laid bare, so they will fall down and worship God, exclaiming, God is really among you.
What then shall we say, brothers and sisters, when you come together, each of you as a hymn or a word of instruction, a revelation, a tongue, or an interpretation? Everything must be done so that the church may be built up. If anyone speaks in a tongue, 2 or at the most 3 should speak, 1 at a time, and someone must interpret. If there is no interpreter, the speaker should keep quiet in the church and speak to himself and to God. 2 or 3 prophets should speak, and the others should weigh carefully what is said. And if a revelation comes to someone who is sitting down, the first speaker should stop. For you can all prophesy in turn so that everyone may be instructed and encouraged. The spirits of prophets are subject to the control of prophets. For God is not a God of disorder, but of peace, as in all the congregation of the Lord's people. Women should remain silent in the churches. They are not allowed to speak, but must be in submission, as the law says. If they want to inquire about something, they should ask their own husbands at home, for it is disgraceful for a woman to speak in the church. Or did the word of God originate with you? Or are you the only people it has reached? If anyone thinks they are a prophet or otherwise gifted by the Spirit, let them acknowledge that what I am writing to you is the Lord's command. But if anyone ignores this, they will themselves be ignored. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, be eager to prophesy and do not forbid speaking in tongues, but everything should be done in a fitting and orderly way. Here ends this reading. Praise and thanks be to God.
Amen. Conversation today about worship. This is what Paul is talking about in this section of Corinthians. We've kind of broken it up into sections. Again, the first four chapters was really about aligning yourself with Christ and getting over who you follow or what your denomination or whatever your tribe is. It's all about Jesus. And in the second part, he was dealing with some moral issues, especially how to live in a very hyper-sexual society, very similar to ours, and what we should do and not do, and about marriage and divorce and all of those things. Then he began to deal with idols. They lived in a culture where people worshipped idols, and meat was sacrificed by idols, but it was the only place to buy meat. And how do we interact? And what's our freedom in interacting with a world of all kinds of different beliefs? And how should we as Christians properly use our freedom? Because we have tremendous freedom, but we need to be careful. And then Paul goes into talking about their worship services. And he talks about praying and prophesying, and he did talk about women and head coverings, and we will talk a little bit towards the end of the sermon about that line about women and their role in the church and how it applies today. But a couple weeks ago, we talked about some of the cultural differences between our culture today and the culture then. And he spoke to them about communion and about the Lord's Supper, and they were abusing it. He says, I'm embarrassed. If you remember when we celebrated with our junior disciples a month ago, Paul said, your meetings do more harm than good. Imagine your founding pastor or apostle coming and saying that about your church. Your meetings do more harm than good. It'd be better if you didn't even meet. So now get it together, he says. And he talks to them about communion. And then he goes on to talk to them about spiritual gifts and say, listen, when you come together, you all have different gifts. And they're not just for you to boast about your gifts, but they're given to you for the sake of others. And when you come together, some of you have a gift of knowledge. Some of you can teach. Some of you can preach. And some of you have gifts that are not just for the body as it gathers, but for the body as it scatters and gets out into the world. And you can do miracles, and you can do evangelism, and you can heal, and you can speak in tongues. We'll get into that in a minute. And then he says, but listen, in all of this thing, with all the gifts and all the other things, there's one rule that is more important than anything else, and that is, what do you think it is? What is it? It's love, right? Thank you for listening, Marianne. In spite of the pain your dog is in. Love. Love is so important. That was last week, 1 Corinthians 13. And it's the glue that holds it all together. And now he's going to kind of wrap up with some final instructions about worship. And I've said, because he's mentioned it several times now in his book, that today we would deal with speaking in tongues. So when the early church gathered, it was probably more like, I picture it more like a Bible study, like a home fellowship. They didn't have really buildings like this. They did have synagogues, which were kind of set up like this. So maybe it was a little like that, with people gathering around and someone would stand up. But I see it more as this kind of informal kind of gathering. And people would bring what God had put on their hearts to the worship. Some had a song. Some had a word of knowledge, wisdom. Remember, there was no Bible. There was the Old Testament, and Paul did say, read from the Old Testament. There was no New Testament. So they had to remember and recall through the gift of the Spirit the message of Christ and the gospel. And so they would gather together and they would speak one after another. And one of the things that occurred was this thing they call speaking in tongues. Now, speaking in tongues, we all speak with our tongue. Every time I think of, you can't. But speaking in tongues really means speaking in other languages. And where did it begin? It began on the day of Pentecost. If you remember the story from Acts chapter 2,
The disciples were all in one place, and suddenly a rushing wind blew through the upper room where they were hiding because they were kind of timid and unempowered and afraid. And the Holy Spirit rested on them, and what appeared to be tongues of fire. Interesting additional use of the word tongue in this case means like a flame. It's hard to know exactly what that means. Appeared on them, and they began to speak in other tongues. And then they burst out of the room. And Peter, chief among them, stood up and, after previously being a coward, now filled with the Holy Spirit, burst out and said, "Let me tell you what's going on." And others burst out, and they were speaking in languages that they didn't even know. But there was a great crowd in Jerusalem because the day of Pentecost was a Jewish feast. And people said, "We hear them speaking about this Jesus in our own language, but we know they don't speak it." And it was a miracle. And so it became associated that when the Holy Spirit was poured out, people would speak in other tongues. When Peter was called to the house of Cornelius, and God blessed them with the Holy Spirit, when he came back and reported back to the disciples in Jerusalem, he said, they were filled with the Holy Spirit and they began to speak in other tongues, just as we did when we first received the Holy Spirit. So in the early days and in the early church, when the Holy Spirit was poured out, people would often break out into praise to God in languages that weren't their own. And when the church would gather, people would come and they would say, "The Lord has laid something on my heart," and they would speak in a language that wasn't their own. Now it seems like early on in church history, that gift disappeared pretty quick. The early church fathers say, even as early as like the 3rd century, would say, well, it seems like these miraculous gifts like speaking in tongues and healing and miracles, they've ceased to be, and they must have just been around for the beginning of the church to help establish it. There's a lot of people who still believe that today. But something very interesting happened in church history in the 20th century. In the United States, and basically in the Western and California West part of the United States, came the Pentecostal revival. People began to search the scriptures and say, we want more life in our faith. We want more spirit. What is the evidence of the spirit? And there began to be a movement that said, you know what? In the early days of the church, when the Spirit was poured out, people began to speak in other tongues. And so there was this famous revival on Azusa Street in California, in Los Angeles, and people began speaking in other tongues under the preaching of an African-American named William Seymour, and the Pentecostal movement was born. It's had a huge impact on the United States. It's actually been good in some sense to breathe a little life into crusty old Christianity. The Pentecostal movement grew and became the fastest growing denominations and movement of Christians in the 20th century. It could possibly still be today, although there's tremendous growth in the Catholic Church in the Southern hemispheres. But even that has a little bit more of a Holy Spirit and a Pentecostal flavor. But Pentecostalism has grown like wildfire around the world. And it even infiltrated, especially in the 60s and 70s and 80s, into mainline Christianity. I know there was, and that was called the Charismatic Movement. And the Charismatic Movement had quite an impact on Emmanuel Lutheran, because I know some of you went there. I know that a previous minister here, and especially his wife, was very much a charismatic and believed she prayed in tongues and had the gifts of the Spirit. It even infiltrated the Catholic Church, and wherever it went, it brought revival and renewal and a renewed dedication to the Holy Spirit, to the Word of God, and to Christ. It also brought with it a lot of emotionalism and, of course, a lot of criticism. There were movements in the church, and still are, that would claim that unless you can speak in tongues, you don't really have the Holy Spirit. And then in some of these movements, they would say, It's put so much pressure on the followers that unless you pray in the Holy Spirit, unless you pray in tongues, you don't have the Holy Spirit, so they would pressure to say, I have the gift. But then people would criticize and say, I think we're putting too much pressure, and I don't think the gift is real. I think it's counterfeit. Now, here's the flip side of that. Sometimes when there's charismatic gifts, how many of you have ever been around a charismatic circle or have had exposure to speaking in tongues or some of these gifts? Some of you are like, doesn't mean anything to me. But for those who've been around, it can be an interesting environment. I spent a little while traveling in Pentecostal circles and was blessed by it, as I've been blessed in just about every movement I've been privileged to be a part of. But everything has its pluses and everything, I believe, has its minuses. So there's a lot of pressure. And sometimes people, when they get into this sort of hyper-spiritual realm, you can't question anything. So if someone says, I'm speaking in tongues, and you say, kind of sounds like you're just babbling to me. Yandale, handale, shalamala, deshabada. It sounds like you're babbling. Don't you to say that as to speak against God, right? Well, I think God is bigger than that. It's like people who claim to have the gift of healing. I have a person I know who really believes he has the gift of healing, but I question it. But how dare I question God? He gets frustrated with me. He's interesting. He's not someone in the church. He's a family member, distant. And I love him. He claims to have the gift, but he doesn't. And we had this interesting conversation on Easter Sunday one time. It's another story. But you can question the gifts of God, because when God gives a gift, it's valid. If I tell you I believe I have the gift of, which we'll get to in a minute, preaching, which is part of prophecy, you can question that. Don't think so, Pastor. Because if it's real, it'll stand. And if it's phony, it'll come down like the house of cards it is. Interestingly enough, a lot of research has been done on speaking in tongues. There's a great book written in the 70s when it was really a hype called They Speak in Other Tongues. And this guy, investigative reporter, did a lot of reporting on tongues, and he recorded people speaking in tongues and then brought them to linguistic experts all over the world saying, is any of this intelligible? They really let the day of Pentecost speaking in a language that is intelligible, and they couldn't. Nobody could decipher it as anything but babbling. Now we have to beware of babbling, don't we? Jesus says, don't babble like pagans. And you don't need to go into some sort of ecstatic seance or mantra. There's a lot of religions in the world that do that. That just make noise and num 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 or whatever they do. And they think that by doing that, they whip up some kind of spirit or energy in them. And Jesus says, don't do it. He says, you don't need to. God hears you. You can simply say, hey God, I need you. And if it's said in faith, it's as powerful as anything. So we do have to be aware, and we do have to keep it in check. Sometimes tongues, and a lot of people will say this, are a prayer language. Paul says this. He actually says, I wish all of you would speak in tongues. He said, but when a person speaks in tongues, they pray to God. And it edifies themselves and not so much the congregation. I get that. If you've ever been in a very Pentecostal environment, I've been into Pentecostal environment where the entire room is praying in tongues all at the same time. And there's an energy there that's kind of cool, but it seems to go clearly against what Paul is saying here. It seems to be kind of an ecstatic outpouring, and everyone's edifying themselves. And I suppose the whole event seems a little strange, as Paul says it might be for an unbeliever. But there's also an energy there that's interesting. But Paul says, I wish you would have this. But if you can't interpret it, and it's non-intelligible, you should probably do it in private and between you and the Lord. I went through a phase in my life where I said, you know what? Paul says, don't forbid speaking in tongues. Paul says, I wish everyone would speak in tongues. So I began to pray in my prayer place, closet. I'd like to have the gift of speaking in tongues. And I prayed and I prayed. And then I believe one day I really had it. And words began coming out of my mouth. And it was a wonderful, ecstatic experience. And I would tell people, it felt like the Holy Spirit was raking the bottom of my soul and pouring out things to God that words could not express. You know, the book of Romans talks about that. The Spirit intercedes for us with groans that words cannot express. Now, Do I think I was really speaking in tongues? I mean, only God knows. But going back, I think, well, I don't know. I think it was perhaps more the groaning. And I don't want to throw myself totally under the bus, but I tend to make a lot of weird noises around the house when no one's looking. But there's groans that words cannot express. And sometimes in our prayer life, you're like, God, I just, And you're lifting something from your spirit up to the Lord. And sometimes it comes out in different ways. Paul does say, don't forbid speaking in tongues. Don't be afraid to ask God. You might ask God to give you the gift of healing, or of mercy, or of prophecy, or of knowledge, or to be a teacher or preacher. Don't be afraid to say, Lord, what is this thing with tongues? Is it valuable? Is it for me? Pray. Ask. It's good. But Paul makes a greater point here. He says, I would rather preach, I would rather speak five intelligent words than 1,000 in a tongue. He says when we gather together, the message is important. Think about that. The message. We are people of a message. We gather together, and of all the things we do when we gather, when we bring a hymn, we love to sing songs, and it inspires emotions in us, and we sing with our spirit, but we also sing with our minds because it reminds us of great truths of Jesus and the cross and his love and his suffering and all of these good truths. We pray with our spirit, but we also pray with our mind. Our minds and what they think. Intelligence and knowledge is so important. Don't underestimate it. In fact, the church has often drifted into extreme danger when it's gotten away from knowledge and from understanding. Sometimes the church gets caught up in sort of spiritual ecstasy. In fact, one of the reasons the New Testament was nailed down as an authority to keep us on track was because people would say, I've had an encounter with the Lord, and the Lord is speaking. And they'd say things that were totally contrary to what had been revealed through the prophets and the apostles and through Jesus. And so they said, we're being led astray by our over-emotionalism, by all this, and that can happen. So we pray with our minds. I flipped the slide ahead early, and a lot of you look and think, on what point does this have to make? Not only talk about speaking in another tongue, for a long, long time, you'd go to church, and the service or the mass would be in a language nobody understood. So these couple guys behind me, William Tyndale, Martin Luther, they felt led of the Lord. Talk about having a gift of prophecy and of preaching and of leadership to say, we got to change this. It's as if the entire service is in another language. The people have no idea what's going on. So they fought hard. William Tyndale, well, Martin Luther is the German reformer, of course, who gets most of the credit. But William Tyndale was one of the ones who fought hard to say the English people need a Bible in English that they can understand. And a lot of these guys, including him, were burned and put to death for daring to think they would put the Word of God in an intelligible language that people could understand. They fought for that. We take it for granted now. But it was that important that worship be intelligible, that the things that are shared and spoken be able to be understood. That's so important, folks. Don't misunderstand that. And so, when you come together, each of you has a hymn, a word of instruction, a revelation, a tongue or interpretation. If you have a tongue, have an interpreter. That will bless the church. Everything must be done so that the church may be built up. But everything should be done in a fitting and orderly way. God is not a God of disorder. It's also one of my criticisms of our Pentecostal brothers and sisters. Sometimes the services are crazy. I was at a service one time. My brother was Pentecostal for a little bit. It was a healing service. And the elder was reading. And all of a sudden, I still laugh. And I say this in love. I really do. I have grown from Pentecostals. Got up with the Word of God and began running laps around the church, screaming hallelujah. And then people got up and started following him around. The whole place turned into chaos. It was exciting, but it seemed chaotic. Paul says you don't need to be like this. Paul says that spirit is a spirit of order. I believe, like many of you believe, that I have the Holy Spirit. And when the Holy Spirit comes upon me, I don't know, I guess other people experience in different ways. When the Holy Spirit comes upon me, I do not feel like going crazy. It is the most stilling, powerful thing. I get very still, and I feel so empowered, but I get still. The Holy Spirit is a spirit of order. And the Spirit gives us self-control in our lives and in our worship.